dry your eyes. It was to be such pains and trial as you cannot dream of. And I must enlighten you to how deep your darkness is!
Thank you. That is the question. Bedlam, 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 bedlam! Bats in the belt! Bats! Set
Mr. Renfield?
One might hypothesize. Silverman says that the animus, in its negative demonic phase, lures women away from all human relationships, especially from those of real men.
Empty! They took me and they deloused me. They shaved me and they salted me with lies. They wormed me like a dog and wired me up to their bad machine.
Really, Mr. Renfield? What sort of bad machines?
They shoved rubber in my gob to stop it and gave me something bitter and sweet to bite off. They attached wires to my temples. My whole head is a temple full of precious things for my master to come and worship. Because he's coming in his worship. Oh, my master, my worship is coming in his worship. Ah! The machine took the current of my memories away. My memories that fed me and fed from me. And bled me like leeches and drained my life away. Now I am empty. I feed on no life and no life feeds from me.
Correspondingly, the malign or shadow animus in a man involves him in those neurotic pseudo-intellectual dialogues that inhibit him from getting into direct touch with love. So that starved of spontaneity and outgoing feeling, he cannot live it.
Lord, I do sympathize with those who deem it difficult to distinguish the physicians from the afflicted in this institution, Dr. Cox.
Christ! Crother!
Oh. It's fat with life. Strong life and gives life to me. Oh, very good, very wholesome, very tasty. I know a doctor who should try some.
Test it in some
light.
In Mr. Renfield's case, I recommend his medication be continued, increasing by 1 milligram per day over the next 2 weeks in my absence until exactly twice his present dose.
Diet, minimum. Cereals, pulses, no stimulants.
Good God! Jonathan Harker, I do believe. Yes, it is Jonathan Harker. What the hell is he doing wandering around in all that undergrowth? Orderly! Orderly! Mr. Drinkwater, will you please go down with me to the grounds and fetch that man taking all the photographs of Carfax and tell him Dr. Seward... No. Say Seward Major requires the presence of Harker Minimus in his study forthwith. Go on, man. You'll know exactly what I mean.
Dr. Seward? Dr. Seward, listen! Help me!
devil anyone would want to photograph an architectural monstrosity like that. It doesn't be on me.
Put things in. Bad stuff.
Puff!
Piss! Jeez! Bad blood mother's milk! You open up my head to him. Help me, doctor, the poison! It makes me want to let him in! He said, I come in your head to the throbbing of temples, the golden altars and the swelling organs, the ruby light from the high windows that will spill on the floor of my power and my glory. I say no!
Send 1,000 little boys scurrying to butter his crumpets, sugar his tea, find another pot of cherry conserve.
How many terms was it you fagged for me, Jonathan? Was it two or was it three? I must have been a perfect beast.
Actually, looking back at our sainted school days, I suppose the last face I ought to be surprised to see hanging out the bars of a madhouse window is that of the Norm Norwellian.
Happy days, eh?
Drink to them being over.
Now, little Harker Minimus is engaged to be married. Ah, ready announcement of the time. Miss Westerman, eh? The sugar millionaire.
Well, I thought to myself, that's marrying trade.
But I suppose these days, being the youngest son of a baronet doesn't pay many bar bills.
These scholarship boys always wear the worst socks. Mina is the loveliest girl that lived, and I should marry her even if she had it two brass farthings to rub together.
Harker! Jonty, my dear friend, I'm only teasing you. I'm sure Miss Westerman is charming in every way, or you've not loved her.
She is beautiful. And brave, and clever.
And sweet.
And sweet. You've not married then, Arthur? Been avoiding matrimony like the pit of hell?
I've not married. Yet. Oh, Jonathan. When I was 20 and hard at my studies, I thought, I'll marry at 25. At 25, I thought 30 was a fine age for a man to settle down. And now I'm 30.
Don't leave it too long, Yard.
I won't leave it too long. What woman would marry into a madhouse?
Plenty do.
Yes, but my wife would have to do it knowingly.
I'm sure you wear it too hard. You should take a holiday. You said you have some annual leave.
Holidays? Honestly, Jonathan, holidays bore me. I don't know what to do with myself for the first couple of days. I read, I toss, I turn. Firstly, I'm glad to be back with my charges. I'm sure I'm doing something useful again.
Come with me.
Do what?
I mean it. You'll love it. Tonight I catch the overnight from Kings Cross to Whitby. I'll spend 2 or 3 days with me before I go on that long business trip.
To see your foreign nobleman. Do I get you right? You actually managed to fucking cut backs?
Very desirable plot. As he stated, he will tell you himself. Castellated dwelling house, late medieval, but with numerous additions from the later centuries. Notably, a fine tree, gingerbread chimney, restoration westward, banqueting hall with a cross nearly seated.
Yes, well, all the gothic for my taste.
Oh, he loves it.
No, his soon-to-be next-door neighbours here at some...
Batty. Mr. Hawkins, the estate agent we need to deal with. They did not seem to think it was strictly relevant.
Poor man! He does not in store for him! On the nights of the full moon, when all the lunatics...
So, Lupin, do this. Does the full moon actually make...
Not at all, Jonathan. Sheer superstition and stories. Now, I'm offended all this minute, but it's not the neurotic. It's simply an act. It balances the complex chemicals of one called the brain. Your Dracula will find me. How are you, mate? Tame and docile. Not at all antisocial as neighbours.
But your cup. To Whitby?
No, Jonathan, I think not.
Yes, sir, the cup. Couple more conditions. That you make quite sure you do not let my Mina make a busman's holiday of it for you. You see, she has this little sister, Lucy. Sweet kid, really. Mina worries terribly about her. Well, last year after their father died, she went into a sort of decline. Got terribly thin and somewhat feverish in her behaviour.
Did she have a loss of normal female function?
How on earth would I know?
Forgive me. I'm a doctor. I forget how to address laymen. Probably simple girl in hysteria. Attention-seeking behaviour? Whatever the Silvermans and Goldmans say, 9 times out of 10, rest, companionship, some exercise, mental and physical. Wait for a little miss to grow out of it.
But your cup?
Oh, cup! Why not? If we can travel first class, let's go and organise the tickets.
Well, if I'd done as I'd intended and gone back to the office, my Miss Bell could have arranged it all for us.
Miss Bell?
My secretary.
Stenographer, eh? And what's she like to work late at the office with?
Miss Bell? A peach. A poppet. Actually, yes. She is quite delicious.
And you are a married man.
Practically. You're not to temptation.
Well, I'm sure I'm in the wrong job.
What am I, Margaret? Blue-faced nurses with blue stockings and black bread.
Ah, tickets.
Tartan, if all I've heard about nurses is true, then...
Oh yes, my master is at hand.
and I am here to obey his every command. See the moon, Mr. Drink Water, how sweetly she sails. She waxed water, she waved, and my master, he comes again. Oh yes, him come, Nurse Christ, and me, I sit in the wilderness with my pretty birds, pretty ones, little victims. Oh, how they do flutter, the struggling sacrifice, Nurse Christ. Ain't it nice that you quicken the heart, that you give it a little flutter?
Mad bastard! Now would your mouth meet you without drink water? I'm putting you on report. Disobeying orders. And him! Fucking fence in his tape eating sparrows!
Prophet in the wilderness. Proclaiming his coming. Full moon when next she sails. I sail with her. I come.
But first, we must batter down the gates of hell. Then we will smash through and kill him. So we all can live.
I'm all ears and fingertips.
Very well. Take a letter, Miss Westerman. Messrs. Hardcastle, Hawkins, Hawkins, and Archer. Solicitor Law, number 7, the Crescent, etc., etc. To Count Vlad and Dracula.
Leg.
Can I have a little bit of both, please, Florrie?
Certainly, Mrs. Jonathan, sir. Just a little. No, that's too much. Fine. Thank you, Florrie. No thanks, no. I'm not in the least bit hungry.
Lucy, you ought to have a little.
Oh, try some, Lucy. May I please?
No, thank you. A little bit more, Mr. Jonathan.
Oh, saucy.
That's quite everything for now. Thank you, Florrie.
I've spent 3 of the happiest days of my life here with you. And Lucy, the air is like champagne.
Very salty champagne.
I am sorry I've had to be so possessive with Jonathan, Arthur. Business to do with the wedding. Decisions to be made.
I hate making decisions.
Don't I know it? Honestly, Arthur, you'd think the most brilliant young solicitor of his generation would be able to choose between red roses and white for the floral arrangements.
Arthur?
I can't see that it matters. As long as you marry me, Mina. Soon.
It's soon, all right. And the fabric for our dress is not even arrived yet.
Oh.
You've not been finding it difficult to amuse yourself, Arthur?
Indeed not. Lucy and I have been walking, riding, and yesterday even sea bathing.
I did not go in.
But you watched me.
Arthur swam so far out, Mina. He got smaller and smaller and smaller, till his head is just a little dot in all the heaving grey ocean. I got frightened and I called him. I screamed.
Dear Lucy.
everything was under control. I'm a very strong swimmer. Everything was quite all right.
My sister gets very nervous about things, Arthur.
Oh, yes. Crazy Lucy. Mad, sleepwalking, skinny Lucy with her migraines and overvivid imagination. I know what you say about me behind my back. You bitch, Mina. I wish you weren't my bloody sister.
Lucy, my pet. Sit down, don't...
Don't leave her, Jonathan. She's only after attention.
Shall didn't she get some?
Sheer tantrum.
Arthur, can't you?
I'm afraid I cannot take Lucy as any kind of patient or give you any advice of a medical nature concerning her. For personal reasons. For ethical reasons. You see, today I asked Lucy Weston if she would consent to be my wife. And she said yes.
Arthur, you are devil. I had no idea. Mina, isn't this the...
My sister, Dr. Seward, is 18 years old. A child. Someone of your age should see she is far too young and unstable to enter into such an arrangement.
Mina.
Miss Weston, I'm sorry to have sprung this news on you so precipitously. It must be something of a shock. I hope you will learn to approve of me in time and see that your sister's health and future happiness my every desire and concern. Now, if you'll excuse me, with your permission, I'll... Go and see if your sister will walk with me in the garden. Well wrapped up, of course. Yes, I'll see if I can be of some comfort to my fiancé.
Wedding business. Lists, flowers. Who cares? Nina, come with me tomorrow. Come with me and marry me in London. Come with me and we can make a mad honeymoon on my business trip. You can be my secretary.
Jonathan! My inheritance!
Don't let's wait for it. I don't care about the money. You don't need the money. I can make my living as a solicitor. Marry me tomorrow.
Mad, Jonathan. I'm sorry, sweetheart. I'm just being silly. It's all this wedding business. Oh, Jonathan, please, please don't go to Europe tomorrow. Don't go away.
Mina, Mina, Mina. What is the matter?
Such dreams, Jonathan. Such horrible, horrible dreams. And premonitions. I know it's silly.
Come, let me sleep with you tonight.
Jonathan!
Let me come. I'll hold you close and keep all the bogeymen away.
Jonathan, we cannot. Not here at Hartwood. Mrs. Manners would know, and Florrie, and Lucy, and everyone.
I'll sneak in after everyone's asleep. Damn it, who cares if they know I love you? Let me love you.
You must wait for our wedding.
Mina.
No, Jonathan, I mean it. Absolutely no. You can come and stay with me tonight. If you promise not to go away tomorrow.
I can't do that. Hawkins, the senior partner, has entrusted me with all this vital business with the Kells. It's my career, Mina.
God forbid you should jeopardize your precious career on my hands. And now I'm going to see my sister and her fiancé and apologize to them for my behavior. I pray she may be happier in her betrothal than I am in mine. Don't dare come after me! Go away!
I promise you.
whatever the outcome, you will one day be happy that you have done everything you humanly can. Almost more.
Thank you. lay a hand upon my castle.
Count Dracula?
At last. I am Dracula. Welcome, enter of your own will. Come freely, go freely, and leave something of the happiness you bring.
Jonathan Huck, Count Dracula. Let me tell you, sir, I am pleased to see you. My journey has been a nightmare.
Come. Welcome. A Liberty Hall to you, my dear friend. Remember, what's mine is yours.
It wasn't for storms and lightning fit to split the sky, and wind, and wolves. Wolves, you should have heard.
Arthur Jonathan.
Sorry?
Apologies, I use my country's habit of putting the patronymic first. Jonathan, Mr. Harker, evidently you are one of those who have ears to hear. But I have the manners of a barbarian. You are hungry, evidently. Yes, so, probably come, Henry. It is, among our peasantry, something of a national dish on feast days, and the day on which you deliver yourself to me, that is a feast day, yes? Certainly.
You're not dining yourself.
Forgive me, I have supped earlier.
Tried rubber steak. It's bits of bacon, beef, onion, sometimes a mushroom or two, and sort of skewered on sticks and then...
No, Mr. Harker, I do not care to eat this rubber steak. Excuse me. My appetites have grown capricious in my old age. Not everything agrees with me. Nevertheless, I know what I like. Simple things. This, my Carfax. Fine castle?
Castle? Letter from Mr. Hawkins, forgive me. It is. You received the photographs I sent. It is a substantial mansion. It will make a fine home.
And every Englishman's home is his castle, don't you say so? I shall make me a fine English man. It is an unusual name, this Carfax. Perhaps from the French. Capital of Fats. Such corruption of language interests me. Four sides. But then I suppose there are always at least four sides for every question. Is that not so, Mr. Harker?
I would say so. Mina would say that's the trouble with me. I can see something to be said for all of them.
So you cannot make up your mind? Perhaps one of your friends will have to make it up for you. Apologies. I have little society here, you may well imagine. I make you feel uncomfortable because I lose my lightness of touch. This Mina, she is your wife?
Practically. We will marry on her 25th birthday.
Do you have a likeness of her?
Some pictures I took in the garden of the summer house in Whitby, they have.
Whitby? It is by seaside?
Why, yes, it is. It's a fishing port and rather fine resort. On the Yorkshire coast. My Kodak again. the one in the middle. That's her sister, Lucy.
But they are not alike, these sisters.
Mina and Lucy. Good heavens, no. Chalk and cheese.
Night of the day. I feel I know her almost. She seems familiar. She has a Slavic face, this Lucy.
Well, yes, I do agree. The first few days in this country, I saw my sister-in-law and every other servant girl that bought me supper.
You have
very disconcerting, I can tell you.
Tasted the lion of the country?
Sorry?
The old pork pie. I am told it produced queer sting on the tongue. Not unpleasurable. Sorry, we were discussing the ladies. Gentlemen's privilege, you know? Who is the third flower in this English garden?
And that's for it. She's their maid.
Three pretty maids all in a row. You, Mr. Harker, have chosen a queen among the princesses. A proper English rose.
Long on the road. shouldn't dream of doing so. You're so kindly meant, such a good motherly face she had.
I merely meant that it was base, lead. I am somewhat of an old snob. I cannot bear what is not old and fine and beautiful and precious. And that is why I live here all alone, with my memories, the splendid spoils of my ancestors. If you'd throw that leaden peasant thing out of the window, I'd replace it with gold.
I must keep it. It was a gift. Good faith.
Jonathan, if you did not have such a warm heart, you would have little to offer me indeed, believe me. You're Mr. Hawk. He writes well on you. Energy, talent, discreet, silent, a faithful disposition which has grown with him into manhood in my service, and which will, I am fully confident, put itself to your every use and render him malleable to your every instruction. So, tomorrow you must write to our friend, to any other who would reach word of you, and tell him that you stay with me for 1 month from now.
A month? But Count, the business we have to do, while complicated, can surely not take more than a few days to complete.
But Jonathan, I require you for conversation.
Conversation?
Your wonderful English language, it is a living thing, yes, I do not possess it.
Count, your command is admirable.
Dry and library dust on every syllable. I know the grammar and the words, but I do not know how to speak them.
For your English is excellent.
Through my books, whom I love, I have traveled all over your great country without leaving my own armchair. I flow with the London crowds to the brown fog. I flock with them over London Bridge to the heart of the city. The rush of humanity. It's life, it's change, it's death. All that makes it what it is. The books are good, but I lack the living tongue.
I am no philologist.
I could not have you so. I want you because you are young and ordinary. A splendid specimen of the upright young man. A good slangy, the lifeblood of the language, yes? And so when I drink in your every word digested, then I shall put on my straw hat and come out from the garden of my Carfax a proper English man.
Count, I cannot stay with you.
No such thing as cannot. Sleep first. In the morning, believe me, you will feel differently. It's only one axiom in human affairs. That bit.
Listen.
Listen to the children of the night, what music they make.
Music?
Ah, yes, music. Not a true soul but knows its melody by heart the first time he hears it.
They curdle my blood.
Come, Mr. Harker. Blood is not so easily curdled. In Milksop kindergartens, perhaps, tears of the big bad wolf might, what do you say, scare the pretty children witless. But the man whose heart has vented enough to make him worth something, he hears the wolf howl to the moon, his own sometime desolation. It quickens the hunter in him, and in his mind he runs with that grey pack in the night. Can you not hear them? Flowing like a ragged wind over Russia, pouring lower than the blown grasses over the steppe. But there, in the deeps of the dark forest, their eyes are more than the stars, and twice a secret.
They ring our coach. Horses scream and stop still. I looked out and I saw them in the full moonlight. White teeth, red tongues, shaggy hair.
Ah, the dogs of nature.
The other passengers were frightened. There was a girl there. She was terrified. I could feel her shiver underneath her thin shawl. So I held her close. For human comfort, you understand. It's one more to calm a child. was that? She said, well.
Girlish superstition. Surely your memory and reason tell you so. I can assure you, those outside you hear howling are real wolves. For wolves are wolves, never shall be wolves. Well, I make a little joke, it's good, yes. You see what life you bring to my conversation already. But I over time. So, you will make your toilet and I will make your bed. No keeping of servants here, so deep in the forest. So, tonight I will be your valet or chambermaid, whatever you will. Tonight, you are so tired, I wish you no dreams to disturb your sleep. And so, Jonathan Harker, you have a long and difficult journey, but at last you reach your destiny.
Destination.
Ah, you see how I need you for a teacher.
One big happy family.
Yes, miss.
Call me Mina. Florrie, we want but 1 year to a brand new century. Times are changing. We'll have no more mistress and servants. I don't believe in them.
No, miss. But you will still pay me wages.
Of course we will, silly goose. Florrie, I know my sister is a little odd sometimes. Will you help me?
With Miss Lucy?
With Lucy?
Yes. Yes, Mina.
She has a shadow on her lung. Such light sweats. You must have noticed how thin and frail she is. And last winter she coughed up blood. Papa bought heartwood as soon as Dr. Payne made his diagnosis. Poor Papa. He did not know how ill he was himself. Lucy always was a daddy's girl, and he'd have done anything to make her well. The sea air and so forth.
Well, he was right to buy Artwood. Bigby's air's a right famous curative. One of the toffs would bottle and paint and make a bob or two if they could. Tonic them sea breezes, they'll clear the cobwebs.
Dr. Seward, her fiancé, says we have to be very, very careful. We must keep our dear Lucy away from the chills of the evening or the dampness of dawn.
Miss Lucy, what's the matter?
Lucy! Why can't they let a girl marry 3 men at once? Or at least as many as want her.
3!
Poor Edgar Homewood asked me to marry him yesterday. He was so sweet, Mina. I broke his heart. And when he saw me cry, he said he was a brute for upsetting me. And today, Quincy Morris. Oh, Quincy, I am so sorry. But I have promised to Dr. Seward, whom I love more than all the world.
I should have thought you'd be pleased being so proposed to, Miss Lucy.
Oh, Florrie, I'm so miserable.
There, there. Oh, Lucy, don't be so silly! Don't be so shallow!
Shallow? Lucy, I'm sorry. I'm not quite myself, and I'm very tense. I'm going for a walk. I'm going past the post office. I'll stop there to see if there's any mail. Florrie, look at the mess in there.
Things everywhere. Go tidy it up.
Yes, Mina.
Change the flowers in the drawing room and straighten the antimacassars in the parlour.
Yes, miss. You mustn't mind Mina, Florrie.
No, miss.
I know that sometimes she's a little odd.
Yes, miss.
Abrupt almost. I know she's sharp sometimes, but she's upset, naturally. All this time, not a scrape of the pen from Jonathan.
she means well, sorry. We're both terribly pleased with you. Yes, miss.
I didn't think we'd find anyone else who'd do for us.
Oh, there's always someone who'll do. You'll find Sales will find out, Miss Lucy, never fear. You might find yourself insulted how quickly they forget you.
I don't think so, Florrie.
No, miss.
Do change those drawing room flowers. Those roses are so funereal. Something pretty to cheer me up.
Don't believe in servants. Don't believe in servants. Well, that's very interesting, Florrie, my girl. Better look in the mirror. Look in the mirror and pinch yourself and see if you're real.
All men are mad men in some way or another. And you deal with your mad men in one way, so that the world deals with God's mad men in another.
Thank you.
too can love you yourself. You can tell it from the past, is that not so? When I have finished with him, you shall kiss him at your will. Now go.
And us? Are we to have nothing tonight?
Jonathan is fine. And look at your lovely dress.
Oh, I do envy you. It's a dress, your wedding dress. Beautiful, Mina.
Oh, Lucy, I don't think I'll ever wear it.
Brave bracelet, strong, sweet with kingdom, and a wholesome hunger.
She pressed on her belly and she said, "Can you feel anything?" "No, Mum."
says poor Fanny. Just something like little bird fluttering.
Well, says Wazel, did you not feel that little bird going?
No, Mum.
Well then, by crash, you'll feel it come back out again. Well, I'll see if daughters have got a laugh. I reckon else we'd sit down and cry.
Miss Bean, is this for you? Oh, he's safe! Oh. He's safe! Budapest, I must go to him. Zoe, pack for me straight away. One change of dress. Oh, I must get tickets. Miss Meany, you can't go all the way to Budapest. Yes. He's been ill. He's in a convent hospital, but he is better.
Where is Budapest? You can't go off to foreign places all on your own. Florrie's right. How can we do
it? Oh, no! Of course I must. To Jonathan. To my husband.
Miss Meany, are you sure?
Of course. Oh, Lucy. Lucy, laugh for me. My darling is safe.
I knew it. Oh, Meany, I knew everything would be all right.
HCL 3 OH2, a triple dose, twice daily.
Yes, sir.
That's a sewer. Don't go to her. Don't leave me here. You leave me, I'll let him in.
Be long gone, Mr. Renfield.
Don't.
It's not as if you're my only charge, Mr. Member. A triple dose. Three times a day, twice a day, 2 weeks till the mania is abated. Family duties, Mr. Renfield. My future bride. Patients forget even we doctors have private lives, eh?
She'll let him in! That'll get ya! She! So on! Sewer, you hear?
She sewer all.
Oh, pretty Lucy in the daylight. Sold her life. She got it all sewn up. Oh yes, no sweat. Come night, they're all mad up in Yorkshire. Set up. Screw Lucy. Screw Lucy? She does. They do. She rides the ragged all round and round and round and round and round and round. East riding, west riding, north and south. Got to watch a man. Slow his bride, virgin bride. She'll let him in. That'll get ya!
Come walk, Arthur. You let me take my time and give me an arm to lean on.
Nonsense. You're light as a feather.
Feather floated onto my lap as I sat on the terrace watching all the swallows gather under the eaves.
Off to Africa.
What?
Winter in the war.
Once your sister comes back, maybe we'll send you and Florrie off to some spa. Fine ladies, eh? Now we'll let Florrie make us comfortable, shall we?
Florrie, don't! I can't bear to look at myself.
Well, once we get those roses back in your cheeks.
Don't light that lamp!
Why ever not, miss? I can hardly see beyond my own nose.
Because all the pretty furniture for lying things, they're flying to the flame and singe their wings.
Dizzy articles.
Oh, Florrie, I'm so frightened.
Oh, don't say that, Miss Lucy.
It was so strange, Florrie.
Oh, dreaming, sleepwalking. Gonna cut your desk so far out at night and not put your nightdress.
No.
No, I didn't quite dream. It felt real. It was real. Through streets, over bridges. A fish leaped as I went by and I leaned over to look at it. And dogs howling. The whole town full of dogs howling all at once. As faster, faster, faster up the hundred steep steps to the graveyard. The only spot in all the world I felt I wanted to be. I was asleep. Something long and dark with red eyes like the sunset. And something very sweet and very bitter all round me at once. And sinking into deep green water, singing in my ears, drowning. And everything passing away from me, my soul from my body, and it seemed to float about the air. This lighthouse was right under me, and a sort of agonizing feeling as if I were in an earthquake, and I came back. And you, shaking my body, I saw you do before I felt it, Flurry.
Bad dreams.
Every night, Flurry. Scratching, flapping at the window.
Moths at the pane. A loose ash rattling. Rat got a hand the wainscot. Miss Lucy bosses all kinds of things.
Don't tell me it doesn't exist.
No, Miss Lucy, I'm not saying bogies don't exist. I'm just saying they're all kinds and sorts of things except bogies.
I'm frightened, Flory.
No use being frightened.
And I think you're frightened too.
No.
You're sad. Flory, why are you so sad? Do you miss your sweetheart?
How do you know I've got a sweetheart?
I know things, Flory. I know more than people think. I'm not just a little girl, Flory.
No, miss.
What's he like, Flory?
Who?
Your gentleman, your lover.
I suppose it's all right sometimes.
What's his name?
Jem, miss.
Jem. Your precious.
No, he's a soldier.
Flory, do you let Jem love you?
How do you mean, Miss Lucy?
Oh, Flory, you know what I mean. You're not a child. Is it nice, Flory?
Oh, I suppose it must be, or else it won't be so popular.
Is it absolutely the most sweetest, delicious, swoony, magical, marvellous thing you've ever?
It's nice at the time, for sure, Miss Lucy.
Oh, Flory, what's it like?
It's very strange. It's very ordinary.
Flory, don't you think Arthur is absolutely the only man in the world for me? He's so clever, Flory, a brilliant man. He has the most remarkable mind. And he drags himself up by his own bootstraps, just like Papa. And he's so good and fair and, oh, so reliable.
Miss Lucy, I wouldn't talk so you'll tie yourself out of talking.
He said he's Miss, is your Jem steady?
No, miss.
When he goes, will you miss him terribly?
Well, I suppose I will. But he's not gone till tomorrow, so I'll start missing him then.
But there's all night tonight, isn't there, Flory?
There's all night tonight. Miss Lucy!
Oh, Flory, of course you can. Our secret. Now, I don't expect you. Don't dare come back till after breakfast tomorrow.
All decent. Can I come in?
Arthur. The last rose of summer. Arrange them for me, Flory.
Yes, miss.
Oh, she's still terribly pale.
Yes, sir.
Don't you think she's any better than yesterday?
Well, she's not any worse, Dr. Seward.
Flory, thank you for letting me know.
Then Mrs. Manners was right to write. She wasn't sure when I asked her to.
You did the right thing, Flory. I've written to my old professor who lives in Amsterdam. I've asked him to come, urgently.
What are you two plotting about?
Just asking her how her patient is doing.
Well, if you want to know about my bowel movements, I wish you'd ask me.
Lucy!
Oh, Arthur. You are funny, darling. Did Flory make me pretty? Do you love me even though I'm sick?
More than ever, sweetheart.
Roses. Roses, oh, I do love roses. So sad when all the pretty petals fall. Mina and I used to gather all the petals in the garden when we were little. I put them in a jar with rainwater and tried to make perfume. Did you ever do that, Flory?
Oh, I should think all little girls did, Miss Lucy.
But after we left it a week, it always festered. Stink and fur.
grass and then would turn it into poison. We'd put in, oh, a dead mouse and pee and poison pots off the lupins. It was even better fun making poison than making perfume. Don't you think anyone would rather?
No. No, I should think most people would prefer the perfume, only others easier.
Off you go now, Florrie. And I want you back here when we meet earlier. And not one moment later. Do you hear me?
See, I can't. Not yet. Besides, it would upset you. You know it would. It would terrify you.
Maybe I want to be terrified.
Lucy!
Well, Arthur, I do hate it when you protect me all the time. Well, I love it, but I hate it too. Tell me the story of Mad Mr. Enfield again. Tell me his story, Arthur.
Lucy, but you know it already. Why did I ever...
Almost scare the pants off me. Tell me again. I thought it was funny. When I was a little girl, I made Bahar tell me the same stories over and over.
Lucy!
Tell me how once upon a time you went into a madman's padded cell.
Lucy, Mr. Enfield is presently in a private ward for his own well-being.
And you could see by spreading bits of rations he'd attracted vast hordes of flies. Great, bloated, buzzing beasts with steel and sapphire on their wings. But the good doctor knew he could not deprive his patients of his pretty pets, so... But next time doctor came, it was spiders. Spiders and great columns of spidery figures, all written in a notebook recording their tiny lives and deaths. The fattest spiders he fed on the fattest flies.
You realize I broke the confidence telling you? Confessions between madmen and psychiatrists were sacred as those between priest and sinner.
And 1 week later, tame sparrows. Next time, Dr. Cater visit, the patient down his knees, keening and fawning, and he said, Dr. Seward, please, can I have a little pussycat?
Lucy, whatever could have possessed me to tell you such a story?
Arthur, stay with me tonight.
Lucy, of course I'll stay. I'll stay with you all evening.
Arthur, I mean it. Sleep with me. Hold me. Love me all night. Oh, Arthur, I'm so terrified.
I cannot! You are ill, Lucy. I cannot take advantage. I have a sacred oath. I cannot break it. What kind of man? Lucy, not in the absence of your sister, who is your guardian. It's not fair for you to ask me.
Arthur, don't leave me alone.
Florrie will be here. We'll make her up a cot bed at the foot of yours, that even if you move in your sleep, she'll hear you.
She won't. Oh, Arthur, please.
Lucy, I'm going away now. Send Mrs. Manners in with a little brandy and water. And something special to make you sleep easy. Once you're asleep, I'll sneak back in and kiss you.
There is no time to be lost!